today's show, we talk about Nerdfighters.
And a piece on Doug the Jump Roper.
And summer fashion.
Good morning, Staples.
Woke up cold one Tuesday. I'm looking tired and feeling quite sick. I felt like there was something missing in my day-to-day life. So I quickly opened the wardrobe, pulled out some jeans and a t-shirt that seemed clean, topped it off with a pair of old shoes that were ripped around the seams.
Good morning, Staples. It's Tuesday, June 11th. I'm Hannah Foley.
And I'm Ambictaldo.
Today's show is the last for the Period 8 TV production class, which means it was completely produced without Zito or Honeycutt's help.
We hope you enjoy it, but before we move on, please stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're starting off today's show with Mimi's interview with Mr. Dodig about how to make our school safer.
Take it away, Mimi.
Have we at Staples ever had a major situation where students and or teachers' safety was at risk?
No. I've been here 9 years. There's never been a crisis of that kind. Here's our there are two kinds of security. One is security, well, breach of security from the outside. And that's tough. Because if you look at our building, we must have 80 doors. And it's all glass, right? We're surrounded by glass. So if someone is determined to break into the school, to do harm, there really is no way for us to prevent it. You know, it's just how fast can the police get here is basically, and that's why we do lockdown and or an evacuation. So I have very little control over that. A threat from the inside, however, coming more than likely from a disgruntled student, we do have control, and that's why you hear me speak often about the need to treat each other with respect, that every kid has to be known by more than one person. When I talk to my faculty, I always talk about loving kids, and you know, yes, you get paid to teach whatever, Greek, but you, in my opinion, are also being paid to really care about your kids. And so we have much more control over preventing some angry person in school from running rampant in school and causing harm than we do from the outside. The biggest problem we have here is we have so many doors, and I find doors open all the time. You know, and convincing everybody who lives in this building for 8 hours a day that it really is inappropriate to open a door for somebody. And of course the answer is, well, I know who she is and I know who that is, and so it's really hard.
Have you worked in any other school districts?
I have, 6 other school districts, and my first month on the job in one of them, which was an urban area, my secretary told me that they got word that there was going to be a drive-by shooting at 1:30, and I said, oh my goodness, what are we supposed to do then? She said, oh, we always get these, and you just have to get a message to all the teachers on that side of the building. It shows how there are at least two Americas, if not several more, and that we are fortunate to live in a community like Westport where, I mean, violence like this rarely happens. I mean, it can happen anywhere, but it's not an everyday occurrence. And where we come to a school where pretty much, by and large, as a student, you can be kind of who you are and not worry about people picking on you and picking fights with you, and you know, you're afraid to go to the locker room, you're afraid to go to the bathroom. But that's the way a lot of high school kids live, you know, not in Westport.
Up next, we have a feature on a member of our class, Doug Ragosa.
A few weeks ago, many of you saw Doug jumping rope in the variety show, so I wanted to find out more.
Here's your interview with Doug.
Just came to
with Doug, a jump roper you may have seen in the variety show. Where did you learn all the tricks that you know?
I just throw the rope around and I see new tricks that I can come up with. And like just anything that looks pretty cool.
What are some of your favorite tricks?
Some of them include the butt bounce where you obviously just jump on your butt. There's the release that they showed in the video, and there's the TJ where it's a triple jump, triple under, and you swing the rope under your leg.
Where'd you start?
I started in Newtown 6 years ago when my mom, she signed me up for Parks and Recreation, the jump roping club there. And I met Pamela Patterson and a lot of new friends, and we just started jumping rope.
I got in touch with Miss Pam, Doug's old coach from Newtown. How does jump rope work?
There's teams throughout the United States and the world, and kids and adults get together and learn how to do a bunch of different events like double dutch or single rope freestyle or speed jump roping. And it's just a great sport for competing and then also doing performances where you could do lots of tricks and get really fit and have fun with friends.
What is freestyle?
Freestyle is basically tricks. So freestyle can be with one rope and one person and doing a routine, like you would see a routine from a dancer or a gymnast, where you combine tricks. The harder the better, and the more complex the better, and the more unique the better.
What is speed?
So speed is basically, picture somebody jogging, so they're alternating feet. One, two, one, two, one, two, and then the rope is going under each foot as fast as you can. So it's just trying to jump as fast as you possibly can without messing up.
What are some of the competitions?
We started going to regionals, which is the qualifying competition for nationals. So regionals we went to every year, and these were mostly the really good jumpers who were really serious about what they were doing. And then when they qualified, we got to go to nationals. So we went to nationals a couple times. Doug went three times to nationals, and that's competing with the best jumpers in the nation. So just watching them was amazing, but being there was pretty special.
What was it like to compete in nationals?
Well, first it's kind of really scary because you have the butterflies in your stomach, and it's just like a lot of fun, and you meet a lot of new people, and you learn a lot of new tricks too.
Do you have any future plans for jump roping?
Well, I'm hoping to start a club or a program, either with the Parks and Rec or like privately owned. And I'm hoping to teach the either stable students or young kids jump rope and a bunch of different tricks and like inspire them to go further on than what I did in jump rope.
Sounds cool.
For their final piece, Hugh and Jack decided to head down to the College and Career Center to find out more about summer jobs and the job bank.
Here's what they found out.
Hi, I'm Chuck Freeman, and my group wants to know how a stable student should get a job over the summer. So we asked Ms. Fugit to find out.
Stable students are interested in getting a job over the summer. They can come into the College and Career Center. We have a book called The Job Bank, and anything that we get into the College and Career Center, we post in the Job Bank, and students are welcome to come in anytime and flip through this. Jobs come in all the time and go out all the time, so it's worth it to keep stopping by, even if you stop by and there might not be something there. There might be something that comes in, you know, the next day. So it's worth checking out all the time. There are some jobs in there now. Once you get a job, you will need something called a promise of employment. That is a sheet of paper that you can get from us. A lot of employers already have it. You get that before you get working papers. So once you get a job, you will need this promise of employment, and the employer will fill that out and on their own stationery, and then you bring that back to Mrs. Flaherty or myself, and we will issue working papers. So working papers come after the promise of employment, and then you are on your way and employed for the summer.
You can also ask the College and Career Center to email your employer your promise of employment forms. Now back to the host.
Thanks, guys.
Speaking of summer, we now turn to Kelsey for some fashion tips on how to look cool.
Hi, Staples. Since summer is right around the corner, I wanted to find out what kind of clothing you should wear this summer.
Okay, I'm wearing a Lilly Pulitzer-inspired outfit today because I'm tired of wearing pants and it was a dreary day, so I decided to wear something bright and summery, which this is the perfect summer outfit. A light, airy skirt, and it's full of color. I have my flip-flops on and my summer bracelet, so I'm all set for summer. All we need is good weather.
Glasses and booty shorts for summer. I usually like to wear like nerd sunglasses, a tank top, and I know that colored shorts are like the new thing, so I wear those, and comfy shoes.
First of all, it's a summer outfit because I feel a little silly in it, and summer is silly. So I have a white top for after Memorial Day. I have bright colored capris on and flowery flip-flops. I think that's pretty summery, especially for me.
I know it's hot, I know it's summertime, but there's no reason to flaunt everything you've got. You need to cover up a little bit.
I would say that this outfit is particularly good for traveling abroad. This is something that I bought to go on vacation to Italy. And the reason why I bought this is because the material does not wrinkle a lot, so you can roll it up. It also is easy to wash very quickly and dry. But also the reason why I like it for traveling abroad is if you go to European countries, their style sensibility is a little bit different than American style sensibility, and they tend to judge you on what you wear, and so you don't want to be looking like a tourist. So if you dress a little bit more formally there, then you don't get harassed.
Hello, Staples High School. I suggest you wear Sperry's with no socks in the summer. So why don't you stay cool while you're in the hot temperature?
In the summer, I like to wear sundresses.
Yeah, same. I like wearing summer dresses and shorts and like tank tops.
Stay classy, Staples. Now back to the host.
Thanks, Kelsey.
As the weather gets warmer, we know you'll all be rolling down your windows and turning up your music.
With this in mind, Liam, Ben, and Knox decided to conduct a phone interview with Elvis Duran, the host of the radio show Elvis Duran in the Morning Show.
Here's their piece.
Hi, Staples. We had the privilege of interviewing Elvis Duran from Z100 Morning Show, and here's what we got.
And welcome the superstars. We welcome the ones we want to talk to.
What made you want to do radio?
I grew up listening to radio because I liked the music, and I loved the people who talked between the songs and gave away tickets to concerts and talked about the artists and stuff. I've always had a deep interest in music, and so that's how I got hooked. And then I didn't have a ton of friends growing up, and so I was the geeky, unpopular kid in school. So, you know, my radio was my friend at night. I like to listen to it and hear other people on the radio. So that's how I got hooked into radio. And I started working at a little radio station near Dallas, Texas, when I was 14 years old. And I've been in it ever since.
What do you enjoy most about your day and your job?
The people I work with. I'm surrounded by people I love seeing every day. We hang out with each other more than we hang out with our families because of just, you know, the hours we're stuck in that little room together. So thank God I love the people I work with. Otherwise, we'd have a problem. We get along really well, and I just think they're creative and they're fun. They're interesting people to me. And I think no matter what business we're in, radio or construction, whatever, as long as you're surrounded by people you love to be with every day, it really makes a difference. It's pretty cool.
So Elvis, what is your daily agenda?
I wake up very, very early, around 3:45, 4 o'clock, and I get into the station around 4:45 or 5 at the latest. I go online. I have my favorite websites I go to every day to see what the gossip is, see what the latest news is, stuff that could be interesting to the audience. And then we go on at 6. We do four hours nonstop until 10, and then I get yelled at by my management for things I said they didn't like, and then I come home. I usually get home around noon. And that's it. That's my day.
Speaking of artists, Elvis, who's your favorite one you've either interviewed, talked to, or just their music style?
First favorite person I've interviewed?
Mm-hmm.
Lady Gaga is great. She was a great interview. She's a fan of the show, so at the same time, we're a fan of hers. And when she comes into the studio with us, she knows who she's talking to. She knows us by name, and she really makes it easy. But to be frank with you, most of our interviews are pretty easy. They're pretty good.
The Z100 Jingle Ball is one of the most popular shows around. How did you come up with it?
Say I came up with the concept, but I didn't. you know, it started as just a small thing. Every year we would have a couple artists come into a club, a small club, and play, and we'd invite listeners. And every year it got bigger and bigger and bigger. And now it's gotten to the point where I'm surprised every year it gets bigger and better. It's kind of crazy. The biggest artists in music love to be a part of Z100 Jingle Ball because, first of all, playing Madison Square Garden with all those other artists in a room full of people who pay a lot of money to be there, so they're happy to be there. I mean, it's a great night. It's a magical night. You're right, though. There is no other concert like it, ever. There never will be, I don't think. Every once in a while, you'll have these little concerts pop up or big ones, but they're not as big as Z100's Jingle Ball. It's known around the country. It used to be just a New York thing. Now people come not only around the country, but from around the world to come see this thing.
Hope you enjoyed our interview with Ellis Duran. Have a great day, Staples.
Nice work, guys.
Staying on the beat with music, Campbell wanted to find out if studying while listening to music is actually helpful.
Here's his report.
Good morning, Staples. Have you ever wondered if it's a good idea to listen to music while studying or doing homework? Well, I decided to make a sketch and see what Miss Parrish says.
What are your feelings towards listening to music while doing homework?
I think that listening to music maybe like quietly or even music without lyrics while doing some studying is probably okay for most students. I know for me though, especially anything with words, if I'm trying to write, it gets to be very distracting. If I'm trying to come up with a sentence that's going to perfectly summarize the argument in a paper, and then in the background I have the refrain of a song going through my head, it sort of pulls me out of my own zone. So I guess the danger to it is that it could be sort of distracting. But I guess, on the other hand, for some students, listening to music probably helps to block out other noises, like what's going on with their friends or at the library or at home around them.
I can argue with the point about listening to music is not a good idea and how it is a good idea. I personally think that listening to calm music like this is a good idea.
Thanks, Campbell.
And now we turn to Tyler, Rob, Jake, and their piece on Nerdfighters.
Nerds!
Nerds.
Nerds!
Nerds! What is a nerd?
Hey Staples, so me and my group learned that a bunch of students and teachers are part of this thing called Nerdfighteria, and we decided to learn more about it.
Hi there, this is John Green.
And I'm Hank Green, and we are the Vlog Brothers on YouTube.
And we are making this video a frequently asked questions video for the purposes of answering some questions that are frequently asked.
People are often confused, like, for example, what is a nerdfighter?
What's a nerdfighter? Despite what it sounds like, it's not people who fight nerds. A nerdfighter is somebody who is, like me, a geek, a nerd, who is fighting for a cause, coming together to show our support, whether it be our physical support, our monetary support, to help others in the world.
Fighter is a person who, instead of being made out of like bones and skin and tissue, is made entirely of awesome.
So you're saying that nerdfighters don't fight nerds?
No, we're clearly pro-nerd.
Well, Nerdfighters was created by John Hank Green. Some know them as the Vlog Brothers. Others know them by Crash Course or their science channels on YouTube. And they saw that we have this great group of people in the world who are nerds, and we can use that for a cause. And so they created this group, the Nerdfighters, to help raise money for different things throughout the world. I think what I like the most is, up until recently, nerds and geeks tend to be looked down upon in society. And when John Hank Green really tried to bring this group together, because it's a good group, most of us want to make a difference in the world. And Nerdfighteria gives us that ability to get together with people who are like us, who get the same kind of things, and yet really try to do something different. Use like Kivia, Kickstarter to help support people in the world who need that just a little extra bit to do something wonderful. And so we have the opportunities here. Why not help others in the world?
Am I too young,
old,
fat,
skinny,
weird,
cool,
nerdy,
handsome,
tall,
dead,
to be a nerd fighter? No. If you want to be a nerd fighter, you are a nerd fighter.
So that's it for me and my group, Staples. Thanks to Doug for helping us get all the information about Nerdfighteria. And back to the hosts.
Thanks, guys.
Jack and Jack will round out our show today with their report on freshmen who are varsity athletes.
There's some really amazing athletes here at Staples. We went to talk to a few of the freshmen on varsity.
What was it like being a freshman playing with seniors?
I thought it was really helpful. Like, the age, height difference helped me, and they had a lot of experience to share with me.
What are your plans for soccer in the future?
My plan is to see how far it takes me. Maybe that's professional, maybe it's national team. I don't know yet.
So, what was the best moment of this soccer season for you?
I think either my first start or my first goal.
Noah, what was it like being a freshman playing with the seniors?
They really made it a really good experience for me. They made it easy for me my first year here at Staples, and they did a really good job for me.
And what are your goals for the rest of your time here at Staples?
Well, from here I'm going to try to work as hard as I can, get better as a student and as an athlete here.
What was your greatest moment during your season this year?
Well, so far it's been knocking off number one seed Xavier.
Okay, what was it like being a freshman starting on varsity?
I think it was really fun. It was a great experience because the older girls were so nice. It was such a new level of competition, so I thought it was really fun.
How long have you been playing lacrosse for?
I started in sixth grade, so about 3 years.
And what are your future plans for lacrosse?
I'm going to play for Staples for the next 3 years and then hopefully go to college for lacrosse. I'd say my favorite part was probably just being with the team in general because we did a lot of things together, obviously on the field and off the field, so it made it really fun.
Thank you, Kate.
Wow, those were some amazing athletes. I wonder where they're going to go with their sports in the future.
Great job, Jax.
Well, that's our show for today.
We've had a great time putting our shows together, and we hope you all have a safe summer.
If they can pull it together, the Period 2 class will be back on Thursday with their final show.
Good luck on your finals, and have a great summer, Staples.
Bye.
Hi, it's Elvis Duran from Z100. Thanks for listening every morning. Big shout out to Staples High School.